Good morning. Welcome most warmly to worship here at St. Nicholas. And if you're visiting us today on holiday or visiting family, we're delighted that you're with us. And we hope you will sign our visitor's book in the vestibule to record your presence with us today and join us later on after the service for tea and coffee in the Kip Cafe. Speaking of the Kip Cafe, Louise is looking for helpers for the Sunday the 21st, that's a fortnight today. We're looking for volunteers. It's holiday time, so many of our folks are away, and if you can help, then you'll be most welcome indeed for Sunday the 21st of July. The psalmist writes, "From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Let us worship God. We sing his praise in hymn number 127, O worship the King, all glorious above." Let us pray. Artistic God, who has created for us such a magnificent palette of colour in this world in which we live. Summer cascades down hillsides. The air is filled with the fragrance of roses and sweet peas. Birdsong echoes from tree to tree, and we are silenced in the beauty of a sunset. As we stand, Lord, on the cusp of a new day, a new week, we offer to you this hour of worship, the work we have to do, the people we'll meet along the way, the laughter and the problems we'll share, the secret sorrows we will continue to carry, and the tasks that will take strength and determination. In this time, you come to supply our every need in the riches of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, amidst the clatter and the clutter of daily living, help us to savour these moments of peace, this time of serenity, where we can turn our gaze towards you. Still our hearts, and help us to listen in these moments for that heartbeat of love which is at the very centre of the universe. We acknowledge that so often the world is too much with us, that we're over busy and the things of the spirit are neglected. We can be so neglectful of the finer feelings of those around us, and a look, a word, a snub can bring so much hurt. Father, we remember and are ashamed. Firmly, tenderly, great God, crush our excuses and mercifully forgive our sins. Work your miracle of pardon and healing in each of us now, that we will be kinder, gentler folk because we've been here today. In the atmosphere of these sacred walls, in the worship of your people, we breathe in your warm fragrance and feel you close. Yes, Lord, hold us close to you now and always. And then indeed we will truly taste the richness of life in all its fullness. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be ascribed all majesty and power, now and always. Amen. It's lovely to see you today, though Sunday school's on holiday, and I'm going to ask you in a wee moment or two to come out and help me, because we're going to sing something, and I need your help when we sing it. Will you do that, Saffron? Will you? Good, thank you. That's good to know. I'm pleased about that. I feel relaxed now, knowing that you'll come out later. Thank you. Now, some folks in our congregation this past week had a lovely time because they were invited to be a guest at the Royal Garden Party at the Palace of Holyrood House in Edinburgh. And they tell me, some of whom to whom I've spoken, they had a wonderful day in the elegant gardens and the manicured lawns. They didn't know quite what to expect. They tell me it was wonderful and it was a fascinating experience. The weather was good, and outside the walled garden, the sun glittered down on the polished paintwork of thousands of cars which had all been washed before they travelled through to Edinburgh. There were top hats and tails, there were kilts and tartan trews, there were high heels that sank into the grass, and there were big hats everywhere, all mingling with the feather bonnets of the proud archers, the King's bodyguard in Scotland. Under an awning in the garden, an army band played. The hills are alive with the sound of music, with songs they have sung for a thousand years. And I suppose that was very true, for just behind the palace is Arthur's Seat, looking down on the city of Edinburgh. And that hill is so steeped in Scottish history. Those old hills have echoed to the chants of monks at St. Anthony's Well and Chapel. They've echoed to the skirl of Prince Charlie's pipers when the Highlanders camped there in 1745, to the throb of mass bands bravely playing in the drenching downpour when Queen Victoria inspected her volunteers in the famous, what's been called the famous Wet Review. But it was His Majesty the King and Queen Camilla that the crowd were eagerly expecting last Tuesday. Every eye was focused on them as the two figures moved slowly around the ranks of guests, stopping now every now and again as one group after another were presented to them. And it was all very natural. And two members of our congregation, Mrs. Wilson and Mrs. Donaldson got to share the king's hand. And now their husbands tell me there'll be no living with them for a very long while. And the kings chatted and smiled and seemed to have the gift of putting people at their ease. And one of my friends from Ayr tells me that he had an old lady sum it up so marvellously as she was helped back to the car. She was badly twisted with her arthritis, and it had been a long stand, but she was smiling. "Well," she said, "well, I don't care what happens now. I've seen the king face to face." For her, a marvellous day, a marvellous occasion, gazing into the face of the king. I suppose she'd often read about the garden party and seen pictures of its pageantry in the papers and in television. Perhaps she dreamt all her life that one day she'd been invited, and now it had happened, and she was as happy as the day is long. That seems to me like a parable. If to meet an earthly sovereign face to face can bring you so much gladness, how much more will the joy be in the presence of the King of Kings? Coming to church every Sunday, we are here to meet Jesus, our heavenly King. How much more exciting would ordinary church going become if we remembered that every Sunday morning, that the King of Kings is here, now. And by the way, I nearly forgot to tell you about the refreshment tents at Holyrood Palace. There were sandwiches and dainty cakes, enough even for the appetite of 3,000 guests, all free. And let me tell you a secret. I heard from a minister friend of mine in Glasgow that someone in his congregation who was also there that day, when no one was looking, smuggled a couple of cakes for her grandchildren wrapped up in a napkin and put them in her handbag. A reminder of the day. I wouldn't like to have seen them by the time she got back home to Glasgow, but she kept them as a souvenir. And I'm sure His Majesty wouldn't mind. Well, boys and girls, here we are in summer. And for many years in summertime, every July and August, Church of Scotland summer mission teams used to be found in seaside towns around Scotland, here in Ayrshire, in Girvan, in Prestwick, and in Troon. And the young folk who made up the teams would work, stay in church halls, and every day they would need services on the beach and have games and activities for the children and young people. Now, when I was young, I was a member of one of those teams for 2 years for summer mission in Troon. They were great days, happy, happy days. And of course, we would sing the well-loved choruses, often with actions, the songs telling of Jesus the King and His great love. Now, I want you to come out. Come on out. Saffron. Come on. Come on. Come on out. Yeah. Come on. Come on out. You coming? Because we're going to sing one of these choruses now, and we've got to do actions. And I want you to look for everybody in the congregation who's not doing the actions. Because if they aren't, then we invite them up here to do it. Okay, you coming out? You coming out? No? You're not coming? No? Right, okay. Right, let's do the actions. Let's try it just now. You follow me. Okay, it's wide, wide as the ocean. Do that. Wide, wide as the ocean. High as the heavens above.
High as the heavens above.
Deep, deep as the deepest sea. Deep is the deepest sea. Is my Saviour's love. I, though so unworthy, still am a child of His care. For His word, open the book, that's it. For His word teaches me that His love reaches me everywhere. Good. Excellent. Now we'll just see how good everybody in the congregation is at that. You ready to do it? I'm keeping an eye on the choir. Now.
Thank you.
part in that. Well done. That was great. Well done. Just forget we're in church and kid on, we're down the beach, okay? That's great. Let's do it. Will we do it again? Yes. Good. Thank you, Saffron. Well done. That was a great help. Thank you so much indeed. That was super. Thank you very much. I'm exhausted now. Getting too old for this. Let us hear the word of God as we find it contained in the scriptures of the Old Testament in the book of Daniel, there in chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6 and at verse 1. Listen for God's word. It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to be in charge throughout his kingdom, and over them three chief ministers, to whom the satraps were to submit the reports so that the king's interests might not suffer. Of these three ministers, Daniel was one. Daniel outshone the other ministers and the satraps because of his exceptional ability, and it was the king's intention to appoint him over the whole kingdom. Then the ministers and satraps began to look around for some pretext to attack Daniel's administration of the kingdom. But they failed to find any malpractice on his part, for he was faithful to his trust. Since they could discover neither negligence nor malpractice, they said, "We shall not find any ground for bringing a charge against this Daniel unless it is connected with his religion." These ministers and satraps, having watched for an opportunity to approach the king, said to him, "Long live King Darius! We, the ministers of the kingdom, prefects, satraps, courtiers, and governors, have taken counsel and are all agreed that the king should issue a decree and bring into force a binding edict to the effect that whoever presents a petition to any god or human being other than the king during the next 30 days is to be thrown into the lion pit. Now let your majesty issue the edict and have it put in writing so that it becomes unalterable, for the law of the Medes and the Persians may never be revoked." Accordingly, the edict was signed by King Darius. When Daniel learnt that the decree had been issued, he went into his house. It had in the roof chamber windows open towards Jerusalem. And there he knelt down three times a day and offered prayers and praises to his God, as was his custom. His enemies, on the watch for an opportunity to catch him, found Daniel at his prayers, making supplication to his God. They then went into the king's presence and reminded him of the edict. "Your Majesty," they said, "have you not issued an edict that any person who within the next 30 days presents a petition to any god or human being other than your Majesty is to be thrown into the lion pit?" The king answered, "The matter has been determined in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which may not be revoked." So they said to the king, "Daniel, one of the Jewish exiles, has disregarded both your majesty and the edict, and is making petition to his God three times a day." When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He tried to think of a way to save Daniel and continued his efforts till sunset. The men watched for an opportunity to approach the king and said to him, "Your majesty must know that by the law of the Medes and Persians, no edict or decree issued by the king may be altered." Then the king gave the order for Daniel to be brought and thrown into the lion pit. But he said to Daniel, "Your God, whom you serve at all times, may he save you." A stone was brought and put over the mouth of the pit. And the king sealed it with his signet and with the signets of his nobles, so that no attempt could be made to rescue Daniel. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The choir will sing the morning anthem, God is a Spirit. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, King of kings and Lord of lords, present with us now within this sanctuary of your grace, come now and listen to us as we plead for our salvation in your name. Bestow upon us your blessing and help us to listen to your word, the word that guides us into all truth, for you are indeed our Saviour and our Lord. Amen. It's always good for a minister to take a step back from the lectionary. Now, the lectionary, of course, is the prescribed scripture readings for each Sunday of the year. And in most churches, if you go out to the United Kingdom, you would find that the same text would be used both in the Roman Catholic Church, the Episcopal Church, and the Church of Scotland. But it's good in holiday times to tread a new path for a few weeks, and the summer months accord us that opportunity so beautifully. Last year, you may remember, if you can cast your mind back to them, we looked at some of the great hymns of the faith and their messages, and then in August we looked at some of the characters from the pages of the New Testament. This year, I've opted to cast a light on some of the giants of the Old Testament, and for the first of those, I've chosen one of my favourites since Sunday school days, Daniel, the figure of Daniel. There's a chorus that we sang in those far-off days, dare to be a Daniel, dare to stand alone, dare to have a purpose true, and dare to make it known. And I can vividly recall a very colourful picture that my Sunday school teacher showed us of Daniel eyeballing the lions as they prowled around him in their den. And I've taken from my text today a verse from Daniel chapter 6, where we read earlier, Daniel went into his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open toward Jerusalem. Windows looking towards Jerusalem, looking in the direction of home. At that time, Daniel was living in Downing Street, Babylon. And it was one of the most splendid palaces in Babylon. And Daniel, the man who stood next to the king in authority and influence, occupied those opulent surroundings. He'd done very well as a captive in that foreign land. Over the years, he'd become very powerful, a powerful political figure. King Nebuchadnezzar had made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon, and when Nebuchadnezzar was dethroned, and when the Medes and the Persians conquered Babylon, and when Darius took the throne, he made Daniel one of the three presidents over the 120 governors of the entire empire. Daniel, this foreigner, had done exceptionally well. Oh yes, he was a bigwig indeed. Power was at his fingertips. But much more than that, as a politician, now wait for it, he was honest, he was a hard worker, and his character was good. Oh Lord, please send us politicians like that. He was good, he was a hard worker, and he was honest. But not everybody liked that. King Darius held Daniel in very high regard. Darius had a soft spot for him. But the other administrators, the other civil servants, were not quite so fond of him. These other guys were very envious of Daniel's exceptional qualities and abilities. And when they heard that the king was planning to promote him yet again, his peers then set about making every attempt to get rid of him. Much like our politics today, Daniel's enemies began to search to find some dirt on him. They did all that they could to find fault with his job performance, but they couldn't. They looked to find out if he could be charged with corruption, but they were unable to do so. They were unable to find one single ground of accusation. They held up a proverbial microscope to Daniel's life. And what did they find? Not one error, not one fault. Blameless. They couldn't find any fault or flaw in his work. Nadia, zilch. So they devised a devious plan to trap him. They got the king to sign an edict that for the next 30 days, everyone had to pray to the king, and for some reason, whether Darius was flattered, he agreed. And they thought they'd nailed it. You see, Daniel's custom, as they knew full well, was to pray three times a day at an open window in his house, a window facing Jerusalem. They knew fine well that Daniel was a man of faith, a godly man, and this edict would seal his fate once and for all. This law would be put in place and it couldn't be revoked. And this thing we talk today about the laws of the Medes and Persians, unalterable. And when the litigation passed, when Daniel knew that the king had signed the document, he did what he always did. He went back home and stayed true to his God. At that open window, just as he always did, he got down on his knees and prayed to the one true God of Israel. Not the pagan gods of Babylon, not the pagan gods of the Medes and Persians. He stayed true to his Jehovah, to his God, a godly man in a godless culture. Oh yes, he could have prayed in secret, of course. He could have sat in an armchair with his eyes wide open and prayed. He could have gone out into the woods and prayed. He could have had his staff close those open windows. But three times a day, at sunrise, at noon and at sunset, the Prime Minister of Babylon entered into that room in his palace and ordered his servants outside, and the door was shut and he was left alone. And he went forward to that open window and he knelt down. That great glittering city that he'd known since his teenage years lay all spread out before him. The voices of the traders in the marketplace, the children playing in the street, soldiers in duties, mothers nursing their babes in arms, the beggars with their alms dishes, the Chaldean priests going about their religious business. That was all going on down in the streets below as Daniel knelt at his window. But Daniel's thoughts, Daniel's feelings, his emotions were not with them. As he knelt at that open window, he passed into another world. His heart was far away in a foreign country. Just as the Scottish exile in a foreign land dreams of a land where he was born, away, far away in the west, 500 miles as the crow flies across the Euphrates River and the plains, and beyond the hills lay Jerusalem, the holy city, the city of Daniel's people, the city of Daniel's God. Remember what another exile had written in the book of Psalms? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand wither, and let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth, if I do not remember you, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. Jerusalem, 500 miles away, was nearer to Daniel than Babylon lying at his feet. Morning, noon, and night, Daniel prayed by his open window. Babylon was forgotten, and he stood within the gates of the city of his dreams. It's a very old story, but its message is ever new. That open window that speaks of a heart that was in exile. It speaks of a soul's yearning for the wide open spaces of eternity, a power beyond ourselves. You know, friends, the surging throng of the world is ever upon us. We live constantly in the glare of the neon lights and the bustle. And the spirit of Babylon is always challenging Jerusalem. That's one of the reasons why the church is facing such a crisis and dilemma at the present time. Folk have become over the years so immersed in the things of the world. They've been so caught up in the pleasures that belong to the passing show that the windows of their hearts have been closed firmly on the unseen world. Oh yes, there were other Jews in Babylon apart from Daniel, and some of them had become attached to Babylon. They'd entered into the life and the spirit of Babylon. They'd flourished in its trade. And Jerusalem and their true homeland had receded further and further and further into the distance. Babylon had cast its spell upon them, and their patriotism was dead. Lives there a man with soul so dead, who never to himself has said, "This is my own, my native land." They were too comfortable in Babylon ever to wish for Jerusalem and the things of their God ever again. And so it happens with you and me too, so easily. If life's western window is never opened, if the breath from the hills of God plays in vain around its closed and dust-laden lattice, if morning, noon, and night, the vision is the vision of Babylon making its appeal upon us, pressing its claim upon us, offering us its prizes and its enticements, then Jerusalem is forgotten and Babylon has won. And that's what's happened in Scotland today. Can you see that? Can you see how the things of God have been jettisoned for the glamour and the glitz that society and modern culture offers us, so much so that God has been pushed out of the equation? And yet, for you and for me, that's one of the reasons we make our way here on Sunday mornings, to open the window, to take time to gaze out to the city of our souls, to stretch our horizons, to link our daily environment with something beyond this present world. That's why we're here. I must confess to you, in the 4.5 years I've spent with you as locum, whenever I stand in this pulpit or come and sit in this lovely building, as I often do, my thoughts are led to higher things. I think of how the very walls of this place are hallowed by the prayers and praises of generations of Prestwick folk. Here children have been nurtured in the things of Christ. Here the strong have renewed their strength. Here men and women have felt the Spirit and the sunlight of God's purifying love upon their lives. Across the years, there must be thousands of folk for whom this church and its services have kept the windows open towards Jerusalem and who've met the living God here in this holy place. And that's why it breaks my heart to see so many churches in Scotland closing at the present time. Buildings that mean so much to folk on their Christian journey. You've set eternity in our hearts, as the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes. And I'm sure that one of the reasons that there is such loneliness in our society, why there's such anxiety and mental turmoil, why there's such a rise in suicides, especially among younger folk, is that we've closed our windows on God. But in its own strange way, it's the longing of Daniel to get his head above the suffocating vapours of Babylon's paganism and to breathe the air of his soul's native land. In that city of 1,000 spurious divinities of Babylon, the open window reminded him to breathe the air of his soul's native land. In that city full of fascinating lures and enticements, the open window kept his life true and purposeful and meaningful. In that city of Babel and buying and selling, the open window gave Daniel the strength and power to go on with life, with its myriad duties, and helped him to carry its care and its responsibilities. And a second reason we need to keep that window open is quite simply to shed the light upon the shadows of life, to shed light upon the shadows of life. There are so many questions that perplex us here, so many shadows and mysteries, so many trials and sorrows and tears, and after 46 years of parish ministry, I could write a book about the heartaches and the burdens and the things that folk have carried over the years and yet have still kept the faith. For that open window gives us a wider vision into the world unseen. For me at any rate, friends, for me at any rate, I readily confess that I need that open window to see all the perplexities in folks' lives, their troubles and their burdens, in the light of that life that is beyond. For me, this life, without another life to complete it and illuminate and explain it, this life is a hopeless enigma, a cruel and often meaningless, haphazard series of events that takes the feet from us and leaves us asking why. Oh yes, I'm fully aware that there are folk to whom this is the real world, the world of the here and now, the world with its plethora of delights and offerings and experiences. There are countless folk who go through life never for a moment giving the world of eternity another thought. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. That's their mantra. And as much as I love this life, oh yes, I love life that's sweet, with its multitude of lovely things to share, I cannot for a moment think of this as all that there is. If you've lost someone very dear, do you ever pause to wonder about that other world to which we believe our loved ones have gone? I do. Oh yes, I do. And often I go to the open window and I gaze, and I gaze, and I gaze. And as I gaze, there comes from the other world one who says gently, "In my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you." And as he speaks, the shadows vanish and the mist lifts, and I see clearly. For Daniel, coping with all the vicissitudes of life, the questions that haunt every generation, the meaning and purpose of what this life is all about, the window in his room was a light into eternity. And finally, We need to keep this window open to give us victory over the world. You remember how it was with Daniel and what that open window meant to him long ago? Babylon had published a decree, an interdict, that there was to be no prayer for 30 days, no communion with God, and anyone found praying to anyone other than the king was to be thrown immediately into the lion's den. That was the law stated, unalterable. Babylon was now challenging Jerusalem. Babylon had pitted its powers against the powers of the God of Daniel. And Daniel accepted the challenge and defied Babylon. You cannot conquer the man or woman who has seen Jerusalem. Babylon has challenged Jerusalem, friends, down through the centuries. It's always threatening destruction upon us, as it is at the present time, always threatening to throw us to the lines of its displeasure, unless we stoop to its godless ways and follow its godless customs. But you and I can let the lions roar, we can let Babylon threaten, so long as we continue to let the light from the western window stream in. Our citizenship, writes St. Paul, our citizenship is in heaven. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We endure seeing him who is invisible. Friends, dare to be a Daniel. Keep praying. Pray without ceasing. Open your window constantly towards our unseen Jerusalem. And if you look out of that window, as Daniel did, I guarantee that you will not be afraid to look into any den of lions. And God will give you a great peace. And whenever you need it, a great deliverance. And now unto God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, be ascribed all honor and glory as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Excuse me. The hymn 495, Spirit of God, descend upon my heart, wean it from earth, through all its pulses move.
Thank you.
Please come to the Kirk Cafe after the service, where our hostess is. We'll serve us tea and coffee, and it's a great chance to get together around the table and make friends and forge strong friendships with those whom we already know. So please do come, and Louise is looking for helpers for the 21st. If you can help with that, then that is wonderful. Our Sunday school is joining with Kincaid Sunday School to hold a children's holiday club in the last week of the school holidays. Now, the Olympic-themed event will take place from Monday the 12th to Friday the 16th of August at Kincaid Church Halls from 9:45 to 12 noon. And we need volunteers to help to look after the children and to ensure this is going to be a very successful venture. And if you can spare a couple of hours during that week, please speak, add your name to the volunteer list on the notice board, or speak to Alec, Jill, or Caroline from the Sunday School. They'll be delighted to hear from you, and I hope that that will be well supported as we join with the young folks of Kincaid. These are all our intimations. Let us present our thank offerings to God. So lavishly you bestow upon us countless gifts, generous God. Accept these monetary tokens of our gratitude and of our devotion, that the things of Christ may ever be nurtured and promoted in our midst, and that we may constantly seek to throw open the windows of heaven in this congregation and parish, filling our town with his peace, his joy, and his compassion. Amen. Let us pray. Mysterious and wonderful God, each day you bring elation through all your many gifts. The thrill of a new day and the sound of a blackbird singing in the garden, the clouds scudding across the sky, the hum of life and the breeze. Our privilege of living in this seaside town with all its many delights, our bowling greens and golf courses, the chance to enjoy a game of tennis or a sail on the Firth, the bustling main street with its charming variety of shops and boutiques and restaurants and bars, the chance meeting with friends in the street as they go about their shopping, the attractive promenade with its wide vistas across the Clyde. Heavenly Father, we thank you that no view compares with that on a summer evening when the sun descending over Arran casts a gleaming pathway of gold across the calm and silent sea. That moment when, on disappearing, leaves the purple hills crowned with a crimson aureole, lighting up the whole western heavens with an inconceivable splendor. All praise and thanks be to you, Creator Lord. Mighty God, Heavenly Father, we admit that so much of life is a puzzle. Confronted by so much suffering and hatred, with so many questions, untold doubts, a turmoil often seething in our heads, often a struggle to believe in the love that we proclaim. Open the windows of heaven, Lord, that we may see beyond the present world. For how far removed we are from the experience of the countless folk for whom we pray Sunday by Sunday. What would we pray were we homeless refugees seeking asylum and safety? What would we pray were we not sure where our next meal was coming from? What would we pray were we living in a land torn by war and bloodshed? What would we pray were we on the receiving end of racism, homophobia, bigotry and prejudice? Were we oppressed and exploited by cruel governments, or crushed by poverty, or racked by disease and denied medical care? In comparison to millions in this world, Lord, we are infinitely privileged here. Help us never to become complacent or insensitive, that we may ever be aware of the world's needs and pains and do what we can in our own small way to make life better, more dignified, holier for all the human family. Into your hands, our Father and Lord, we commend those who have been elected this past week to serve us in Westminster, that in tranquility in the years ahead we may be governed. Our King and Queen and all the royal house, that their public service may be lightened with your holy grace. The Church in all her ministries, and especially the Church of Scotland, undergoing so many profound changes in these months, that cords of love may unite us. Our health service and all who work to heal and to mend, who nurse the sick and support the dying, that your love and compassion may bring hope and healing. Our friends and family who are coping with untold difficulties, with depression, with worry, the unrelieved pain of chronic illness, a breakdown in a cherished relationship, that your grace will bring help to each and your love give hope for their tomorrows. And to you, God of all spirits, be given gratitude for all who accompanied us on the road and made us the people we are today, those who are now safe in a further shore and in a greater light. We miss them every day. Help us so to live that they may be proud of us, and at the last, when our journey is over, bring us safely to be reunited with them in the glory of your heavenly kingdom. Our prayers, spoken and unspoken, we ask in the precious name of Jesus, in whose words we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. Our closing praise, number 547. Lord God, may we keep those windows towards heaven open, ever seeking you and the presence of the Christ. Watch over us as we go our separate ways, and keep us in the strong faith, the faith that was Daniel's. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you, and all those whom you love, both near and far, this day and forevermore.